Literally. What the fuck is going on? I could not help but notice that most people are insanely eager to be perfect. It disgusts me in a way, while I also sometimes manage to laugh about it. Sometimes it is like watching children trying to figure out how to throw a pebble over the Himalayan desert of spirituality and see where it lands. I have no love for such practices, and I have given it much thought to be sure by now that some people won't play with me. It is not that they are slow or wrong or weird or anything. They simply bore me. I sometimes imagine myself as a cat and I could use my powers to turn the minds of the mindless, but I decide to leave them be. An act of courage for one person may be basically impossible for another. Equality does not mean that we are all the same in the sense that we do the same in the sense that we like the same things. One person charges in front and shows the potential followers what can be done. The rest follows if they like. Basic principle of free will. The state tries to make us forget this, of course. It is their job to do so, because as long as they can deceive you into being the government's pet, you are under their rule and therefore they must keep you safe. It is a prison to me, fuck that, a horror. The worst nightmares are being dreamed by witless widows that never squeezed enough sperm out of that old sack to get a child out of it for the money they would get for it by selling it to those governing men. That is what signing your child over to those fuckers is. Child labor. Agent number so and so is now ready for takeoff and must be incorporated into the system. Incorporated or sucked up. Fuck that. Shit away if you like. So it turns out to be my duty in this life to be a bit fucked up and crazy, but not so much to kill myself. Not yet. Shame. All the same. No gain, but lots of pain, grinding teeth and knowing it all. Wisdom floods me like a dam and I have no way of escaping it. I have, decide not to. It is a challenge. What is madness? What is it? What is madness? Seriously. I could tell you, if I would invite you for 1 second into the space in which I am creative, you could never go back to your old life, I promise you that. If you would suddenly pop up in the room that I do mushrooms in, or anything that we ignorantly call psychedelics, you would probably instantly die. No kidding. Truth, that's a fact, and you will probably never understand why. You may get it a bit by trying to understand what I'm trying to tell you here. I could write hundreds of words and books and only 1% of the readers would ever get it, probably less. If everybody would get it, then who get make sure that whatever must happen is also happening? You. Would you do it? Would you stand here and write books like this? Books to free people are necessary to act as Morpheus and leave bits and pieces to the coming generations to use to figure out this mess that we are stuck in. Chaos in a sense. Maturity. I have matured enough now to openly say fuck you to everybody in the room. Amazing. Like I give a damn. Actually I do.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Leidenschaftlich, emanzipiert, sentimental, willensstark, verletzlich, zielstrebig, empfindlich, sinnlich, gebrechlich, friedlich, launisch, distanziert, verrückt, behutsam, modern, empfänglich. Leidenschaftlich, emanzipiert, sentimental, willensstark, verletzlich.
Sleep if you must. Hours have been wasted by people trying to be somebody that they are not. Hours have been wasted by dreams wasting away on some kind of mental shelf, instead of realizing them. Is sleep a waste of time? You think it is, don't you? I think that sleep is wonderful. It is wonderful, but only if you've earned it and if you indulge in it fully, without remorse or shame. Many an hour have I slept during my emotional healing.
I was crushed and I crashed.
I took a face full of dirt and it hurt. Gravel was piercing my skin, only it wasn't gravel. It was emotions. It was my feeling that hurt and pained me, and I remember my father trying to keep me busy while I was sitting in my room, seemingly wasting away to any observer of my sad self. They could not take it. They could not take seeing me like this, but it had to be this way. Many days, even today, my shutters are closed until 4 p.m., because I spend the entire night keeping myself busy, writing, smoking, drinking tea and ceremonial cacao, anything really, just to pass the time, not in the sense that I want to get rid of time. But by spending time with myself, doing what I love, which is being creative and sharing my thoughts and myself with the world.
I love this.
This is my heaven and I just found a new medium. I have tried so many things, weirdly enough, but I just started listening to this and I hated it. You see, love and hate are eternal opposites. I am distancing myself from me as a musician at the moment. I have too. I literally have too, because I lost interest in making music for a while. I also had to sleep it out. I was so busy writing songs and suddenly I had recorded and released 4 new albums. Boom. Crazy shit. Now I am back to writing, which is something I deeply enjoy at the moment. I also would like to be honest again. The reason why I write now is simple. I need to move on. Not just emotionally, but in reality. I am trying all kinds of things to be finally recognized as a writer, or artist in general. Most of all as a person that literally makes sense and has something to say that most people don't want to hear, which is, everybody is miserable all the time. True. Absolutely. I have met so many fake people that claim to be happy and that seemingly successfully write stories on Medium or post things on Instagram, and I only have to take one look and I realize that they don't do it, because they love it. They do it to be loved. They do it, although they hate themselves and it shows. Pay attention and you will notice these things. You can read a story and you can learn a thing or two about the person that read it. Am I in love right now? Partly. I love writing, but I also have to push myself. As much as I love doing all kinds of things, it takes stamina to keep going for such a long time without being noticed or appreciated. It takes a lot of courage. I slept a lot. I slept until I was tired of sleeping and then I tried staying awake as long as I can until I felt tired of being awake. Last night I slept from 5 a.m. until 4 p.m. Then I got up, turned on my laptop and started writing again. First I drank ceremonial cacao, smoked and readied myself. I also showered. This is my space, where I am free to do what I want. It is also my ticket out of this place. Seasoned with numerous experiences, I am literally dying under my parents' roof. I cannot talk to them more than necessary, because they see me as a little child that needs their help. It makes me furious, which is why I stop spending lots of time with them.
I lock the door to my room, also when I leave the house, which is fairly rarely.
I stay inside to force myself to be creative, and it is for this reason that I could create all this content to help people find themselves and help myself find myself. I have figured it out. I know how to be happy and I want to share it. My images sometimes blast me out of place. I get basically hard when I see some of my creations.
I have found ways to channel my sexuality into my content, and I often found myself having a hard-on while painting something.
Sexuality is a big thing for me and it showed me so much about who I am and what I need. I need sex, when it will come to me. I am okay without it. As much as I have tried to get away from porn, I use it to tell me something about myself. I pay attention to what I like at the moment and I ask myself if that is how I would want to engage with a woman. Porn also helped me to understand that as much as I believed to be gay for a while, at least partly, watching gay porn showed me that I have no interest in men. This is a part of myself that I would like to introduce or dive into at another point. Figure it out.
Zielstrebig, empfindlich, sinnlich, gebrechlich, friedlich, launisch, distanziert, verrückt, behutsam, Stern, empfänglich, Tumult, Leidenschaft. leidenschaftlich, emanzipierst, sentimentation, willensstraße, verletzlich, exigent, zielstrom, passiv, empfindlich, passion, sinnlich, mitte, gebrechlich, detaché, friedlich, liberant, launisch, pragmatisch, distanziert, verrückt, delirant, behutsam, engagé, modern, ambitieux, empfindlich. Empfindlich, sinnlich, gebrechlich, friedlich, launisch.
He left no time to regret. Kept his dick wet with his same old safe bed. Me and my head high and my tears dry. Get on without my guy. You went back to what you know. So far removed from all that we went through. And I tread a troubled track. My odds are stacked. I go back to
the story of the old man. Once upon a time there was a man, an old man. Not as you imagine an old man, frail and rickety. The man in question was not a victim of the local orthodox medicine and therefore, wasn't treated most of his life with unnecessary drugs.
You know what? I just thought I'd rather read it to you myself. Alright, I think you can hear me. That's good. I think that's good. I don't know, the camera is like slow motion or something. Maybe it's adjusting to my speed. It's like, Whoa, like the camera trying to capture whatever space I find myself in right now. I mean, have you seen that image? It's insane, literally insane. And these past couple of days, I always had this voice in my head saying, "Take it to the next level, take it to the next level." I'm like, what the fuck does that mean, man? Like, take it to the next level. And apparently, that includes reading you a story and making like some kind of session here. Yeah, I don't know, maybe. Yeah, I don't think I want to do these things live, but never say what you can't really predict. All right, so I'm reading to you now with my own voice a story that I posted on Medium. I'm sure they will appreciate me doing that for them, and it's called The Story of the Old Man. Once upon a time, there was a man, an old man. Not as you imagine an old man, frail and rickety. The man in question was not a victim of the local orthodox medicine and therefore wasn't treated most of his life with unnecessary drugs, which have more side effects than benefits. No. The man in question was a so-called savage, or as he would probably call himself, a human being. Most of his life, this man, who was a human being, lived where he was born, in the jungle. At this point, it is worth mentioning or suggesting in a well-intentioned manner that it is not at all relevant to the course of the story where exactly this was. In fact, as I write these lines, I ask myself how much nonsense a book can really put up with without losing its seriousness. Where were we? Or rather, where was I? Ah, yes, the old man in the jungle. Wait. Properties. Use buffering camera. What's going on? You know what, you don't really have to see me. I know you really love seeing me, but that just takes your focus off what I'm trying to tell you, and then I have to think about, you know, how I'm looking and stuff. So, the old. This is all. By the way, the introduction to the Book of Fear. The old man in the jungle had already seen a lot in his long life. What exactly would probably go beyond the scope of this book, not to mention the patience of the reader. Patience is actually something to linger on for a moment and to raise the question how far you might stretch the patience of the reader in any creative work. I am drifting off again. Relatively near the end of his life, one of the younger jungle dwellers asked him a question. "You, old man, can you explain to me what fear actually is and how I can stop being afraid of fear?" This was exactly the question the boy asked the old man in the jungle. The old man thought for a moment and then he began to speak. "That is a question I cannot answer in a few sentences. I'll have to elaborate a bit, so make yourself comfortable, young one," which I assume you are as well. "You are very lucky because I have been thinking about this very question for many years. Why are we afraid of fear? In fact, I only found the answer after years of observing the milksops. It seemed to me that every time I led a group into the jungle, the participants were very nervous. I made it my business to observe this more closely and to pay attention to exactly what kind of questions they were asking or what was making them so incredibly nervous. In fact, the jungle itself is quite a good example, which I will bring in due course. First of all, though, I want to stay with the milksops because they helped me understand fear better. Through the vo Milksops are just like white people, right? Through people in cities, most of all. Through the white man, I have learned to see fear from a completely different perspective. I am very grateful for that. Fear itself, I have come to realize, is that which is hidden. When we don't see something or feel that something is there that escapes our view, we are often afraid. However, there are other things to which fear can attach itself. For example, it is our experiences that can be a breeding ground for our fears. Before I confuse you with my explanations and you can no longer follow me, let's stay with the unknown for now. When we are in a situation where something unknown confronts us, we are nervous. This shows itself internally through a spreading restlessness or externally through trembling or similar symptoms. Whenever I led a group into the jungle, there were some who were very calm and mastered every situation with flying colors. Others, on the other hand, were very upset and would jump out of their skin and flinch at the slightest noise. They were extremely tense and expected to be attacked by a jaguar at any moment. Why is this so? I asked myself. My understanding is that it has to do with our childhood, on the one hand, and our soul, on the other. Some people come into the world and are very calm, while others are constantly crying. Then there are those who sleep all day long. There are also those who can't see enough of the world and want to touch and examine everything. That's the way it is, and parents who have already become parents several times can certainly confirm this. No child is like another. All are different, all are individual. This is important in order to understand that there are different perceptions for each person and that you cannot lump all people together. Nevertheless, I believe that our childhood has the strongest influence on our development and on how we deal with fear. At this point, I would like to talk about experiences. Experiences cannot be conveyed through words because you have to experience them. However, you can lay a kind of foundation for a positive experience or even a negative experience. This foundation is something we can create through knowledge. The more we know about the world that surrounds us, the better we can deal with new situations. A person who knows nothing about snakes will probably be very cautious in dealing with them. He does not know how to judge them. If a person is taught a lot about snakes, he can use this knowledge in an encounter to better assess situations. This enables him to have a positive experience. This experience will accompany him throughout his life, and he will be able to use what he has learned in other situations and not be afraid of new and unknown things. Now imagine that I would only tell you the scary stories of snakes. I tell you how the venom of snakes can kill you within minutes. I teach you that snakes are very scary. And I only use stories where there is no good ending. So I create a very bad foundation for your first encounter with snakes. You will probably be so afraid before your first experience that you will not be able to approach the matter neutrally. However, this point of view is not a neutral position, but a distorted truth. Looking at something from only one point of view is very one-sided and creates a false picture of the world around us. It is better if I tell you the wonderful things about snakes, but also make it clear that snakes are wild animals that do not like to be touched. I can also tell you about the poison of the snake in a positive way, how sophisticated the composition is and how the snake helps to maintain the balance of the jungle. If nothing dies, then no new life can arise. Nature depends on the balance between life and death, otherwise we would eventually suffocate in living organisms. How are we to live if we cannot feed on other living things? Plants live to the same extent as animals, and both need each other to exist.
So my first message is that it is our knowledge that enables us to assess the situation in advance. However, knowledge that is only conveyed through stories or books can create a false picture. We rely too much on the experience. You see? It's all there, you just have to read it. So go to Medium and fucking read this shit, because, you know, I don't have to read it to you. That's what my podcast is for. Which is now on Patreon. Which you could say is like Patreon. Which means you gotta pay for it. So don't be lazy. I don't know what this is like. Stuck. Maybe it's about the focus, right? Maybe you should be more focused on what I'm doing here. So let's help you ease into it a bit. Peace out.
Hallo. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Take me down, down. Let's get lost in space and time.
took her